I think when we get to a point where we can actually do some of these studies, brain scans of people who are having these experiences, we'll be able to start addressing this explanatory gap in terms of sort of the mechanics of how the brain works versus how it produces these subjective states of feeling and consciousness. And that's the big piece that's missing right now. I think certainly it's possible to take different types of psychoactive drugs that we know have a particular mechanistic function. They interact with a certain receptor in a certain part of the brain, and do brain scans and look at that part of the brain light up after that drug is administered. And then to be able to use subjective questionnaires and feelings to actually begin to start mapping brain states as a function of brain chemistry. That to me is actually a really important goal that no one, I think, has really clearly articulated. But I think we're almost to the point where we could use a library of various types of psychoactive drugs, and coupled with advanced brain imaging techniques, to actually start mapping a sort of cartography between what happens when a particular receptor in a particular brain area is activated, what brain state does that produce, what kind of feeling does that produce. And I think we're not too far away. I think the biggest holdup is sort of social perceptions that, is this something we should do, and should it be funded as a public priority? And to me, you know, that's sort of a no-brainer.
You know, I'm a physician, and I find that for the serious public health issues of our time, that we're impotent. Our medicines are impotent. And with ayahuasca, I had discovered for the first time a medicine worthy of its name, capital M medicine. And as you know, ayahuasca is considered the medicine by many of the indigenous peoples of the South American Amazonian basin, because of its profound ability to transform. And I think one of the most pressing questions about ayahuasca, and I think this is true of all the entheogenic botanicals and even the synthetic materials, is can these medicines not only affect the psychological state of us, but also our bodies? Can we really heal ourselves, our bodies?
It was such a profound experience to have been out there in deep space. And I'm not the kind of person that would have expected this kind of experience. I mean, I would have expected, if someone were to tell me you're going to take this drug that's going to launch your consciousness, I would have expected that I would see angels and fairies and not alien life forms. I have no interest in that. That's not part of, you know, I've never liked science fiction, I've never been into any of those kinds of things. It's not part of any sphere of interest. But to be out there with these other life forms, this greater intelligence, was absolutely astonishing.
As far as I know, DMT is astonishingly widely available in plants and animals all around the world, but so far nobody really knows why it's there or what its function is. Rick Strassman made the suggestion that DMT may be produced in the pineal gland. As far as I know, that suggestion still needs to be fully validated. But it's an intriguing suggestion, because if we look at the origins of the pineal gland as an organ of sense, that it was a sense organ, and that in evolutionary older animals it actually has, a lens and a cornea and a retina, maybe that's what it still is. What DMT is offering us is a different modality of perception. To allow us to comprehend and grasp and interact with the wider reality that surrounds us. And maybe this is why it's there in nature.